Everybody, Scott Webb here, and with my esteemed colleague and CEO of our company, Kitchen Traffic, Kelly Fox.
Hi, everyone.
So, a little late night.
Yes.
In Colorado.
Yes.
It is 10 o'clock. And the reason we want to bring this out, the importance of time, is what are you doing with yours? But we've got six things that we want to go over tonight with you guys that we think can help you. If anything, kind of get a list, and we're really big in lists. So think about your favorite, I don't care what it is. It's a hamburger, lasagna, maybe you make cake or cookies. You got to have a list, right? There's a list of ingredients. And we're going to give you six ingredients that you can use in your business. I don't care if you're a solopreneur or if you're a leader of a big company. These six things apply, and you can just go through them. Tactically, if you would like, some of them are mindset, but for the most part, we put together these things because they're working for us and they've worked for others. So we want to make sure that you guys have them, and we'll have these on our website at kitchentraffic.com/the dip. That'll be here in the video too, but we'll have some other resources as well. But we're going to create a worksheet for you that lists these six things out. But go through this video. Maybe play it two or three times, share it with some others that you know are struggling right now, which there are a ton. Literally, I will just say, let me just set the tone of tonight's video, or this video, is 2020 is the fourth major recession, financial setback. And I know there's health involved with this one too. We've had, so the 2000, roughly 1999, 2000 dot-com bust. I lost a lot of money in that one. 2001, when the terrorist attacks happened in September 11, 2001, literally the world shut down. 2008, Lehman Brothers collapse, market crash, housing bubble, boom, everything shut down. 2020, this thing, we don't know how long we've got, but shutting down. And so Kelly and I are doing some special research right now. We'll hopefully have this out for you in a video this week, but we wanted to compare what's going on now with what happened back in those past ones. And since I've lived through them and ran businesses through them, I think I have a little bit of experience, but we want to give you some hope because there are some similarities. And if anything, if you've lived long enough, now if you're a millennial, especially young millennial or Gen Z, and you're 18, 19, 20, 25, you were a kid in junior high in 2008. So this is like your first real adversity. Congratulations.
Yay,
it's
welcome.
It's a big one. So welcome to adversity, everybody. For the rest of you that are 30, 35, 40 and older, you remember those past ones. And so this is, I'm going to tell you, yeah, I'm a little anxious, but I'm not shocked. Because when you live through these long enough, you figure out a way, and there's always a way. And so I want to make sure that you guys understand that there is a way out. And so we're going to give you six of them right now. And the way we're going to do this is kind of David Letterman style for you young folks. That's probably way past, you know, like David who? famous late night talk show host. And he'd always
stop dating us, Scott. Stop dating us.
It's all right. It's all right. Hey, what I'm trying to impress is we've got a ton of experience. So
yes.
If you're gonna listen to somebody, don't listen to a 22-year-old that was in junior high during the last one. Come to us. All right. So I'm gonna go through these. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Kelly is gonna do 6. I'm gonna do 5. Kelly's gonna do 4. I'm gonna do 3 and 2. So Kelly can finish with number 1 because it is by far the most powerful. So let's get going. Number 6, Kelly.
Number 6 is look for gaps in the market where you think you can do a better job. And this goes for both internally and externally. Sometimes we notice our clients, heck, we even notice it on some TV shows like Restaurant Impossible, where the focus is on the kitchen, but it's not focused on the front of the shop. or somebody's focused on their employees and they're not focused on their customers. And if you're not focusing on one, the other will crumble, mm-hmm. or it's going to have an effect across the board. Why are your employees unhappy? Well, it definitely would stem back to what we'll talk about in number one. But we get so busy working in the business, we forget to work on the business. And this is a phenomenal opportunity where you can really sit back. Scott and I have been really talking with folks who reach out to us and say, hey, take a breather, take a few days here, sit back and see where you can focus on the business, where are those gaps, and how can you fill those gaps in this new normal that we are in, because things have changed.
No, I love it. And I'll just add one quick point here is that the gaps too can also be outside of your business. So if you look in the market and you realize that, you know, in your industry, some of your competitors, they're just not doing a great job and you know they're leaving gaps. You can be, but this is the thing. So often we're so busy working inside of our own business that we don't work on it. So we don't see these opportunities. And when you can understand that using these, I don't know, what would you call this? A reset, a slowdown, a turn back, just a pause, maybe a pause.
I think a pause is a great word.
So while we're experiencing this pause, instead of fretting and stressing and worrying about what's going to happen, go find what your competitors are doing a really lousy job at, and maybe try and fill that need or do a better job. So that's one of the gaps too. But again, when you are so busy inside, you never have a chance to see those. So we'll talk about this in some future videos, but the e-myth is going to be critical to the future success as you come out of this thing. And we'll show you how we're implementing e-myth in our business. But it's the thing that sets you up for success, because now you get to do what you're really good at. And that's not running around the warehouse, the office, answering the phones, and you're there 18 hours a day. Nobody should be in their business 18 hours a day, even now. Okay, let's go on to five. So sharpen your knife, not only the title of our podcast, it is a metaphor for getting really good at one or two skills. So use, again, the pause that your business is experiencing right now to figure out a new skill. And I'm going to tell you the number one skill that will transcend your business, and nobody does it. I mean, not nobody, because there's 100 million YouTube videos, but I guarantee you nobody in your industry is doing a really good job at it. So it is video. Use video every single day to communicate to your customers and to your audience and to your prospects and to your employees. You get out of bed, you go to work, you go to the coffee joint, you go to the grocery store, you go to the networking thing, you go to an employee meeting. There's no difference. It's just a video camera now instead of a human that you're talking to. But if you'll do those other things, but you don't get it in front of a video camera because you're too shy, I don't buy it. Because you get out of bed and you show your face anyways. So show it on video camera, but now you get to talk to people and they can go back and they can re-listen to it. It's got a lot of meaning, but it's a super way to communicate. So that is one of my things for sharpening your knife. So getting a new skill. I'm going to talk about this one real quick and then Kelly, you can chime in. Another one is we stress manuals here to every business we work with. In fact, when we work with our clients, we build a cookbook for them. You need to have cookbooks for every facet of your business, your marketing plan, your employee guide, your systems and processes. Because if you run out of the seat of your pants and some spreadsheets and some folders, but they're scattered all over your computer or your phone, I don't know how you do it. If you're doing it and you're making money, then, you know, that's great. But imagine getting all that into a process, into a book. So right now, during this pause, spend some time getting that stuff like fine-tuned. And that way, when employees are like, well, can I take off for 2 weeks? You're not making it up. You're like, did you read the employee manual? And most companies I know, even some companies that are doing $10, $20, $30 million a year or better, it's like, they're like, well, go talk to HR. And the HR is like, well, go talk to the owner, you know? So that would be one of my things for getting, you know, sharpening your knife and getting those skills. What's this one about customers, Kelly?
Oh, that one about customers and putting your customers first. This is a unique opportunity to reach out to your best customers and really to get to know them. I mean, do you know your top 15 customers, your top 20 customers? This is something we have actually talked about numerous times. We've talked about this on our podcast. We've talked about this on a few other video chats. And now is really a great time for you to reach out to them and not talk about product. Just ask how they're doing. Ask how you can help them. There's all these parents now that are, their kids are off of school indefinitely in some school districts. You know, maybe this is an opportunity for you to say, hey, how are you doing with the kids? Can I buy you a subscription to you know, Disney Plus or to Noggin for a couple months to help you out? I mean, something like that can go a long way with your best customers. And also, you can listen to feedback from them about what is happening in their lives so that you will continue to build upon that trust and keep those customers for life.
Yeah. So that falls under sharpen your knife because I guarantee your competitors are not doing these things. So when you go and do these, you're literally sharpening that knife and making your company better. All right, number four, that is you, Kelly.
Here's the thing. When it comes to what Scott had just said about the camera and you know, I mean, it's not that hard, right? Like, just take a video of yourself. You need to be highly visible at this point in time. This is not the time to sit behind a bunch of encouraging quotes or to post, to rely on your automatic posts that you had set up a month ago. This is the time that you need to be highly visible. Reach out personally to every single client and post daily videos, even if you don't want to. I know it's uncomfortable. I know you can, you know, jumble your words, or it gets to the point where you're just like, okay, this is just embarrassing and people are going to be brutal to me. Listen, if people are brutal, then you don't want to mess customers anyway. But the fact remains is when you have a human face and people can see you and can see the passion behind your business and that you care about them and that you're keeping them up to date and that you're communicating to them, again, that's going to do a long it's going to go a long way to build trust and make sure that they know you and they know the human side of you. There are plenty of influencers, business influencers that I follow that I think that they're my friends and they've never met me before. Mm-hmm. But because
you almost feel like you know them.
You do. I really do feel like I know a few of these people. And it's because they are doing their video every day. They are communicating to me. They're saying, you know, in the hard times, they're saying, hey, friend, I'm here for you. And I get it because we're experiencing this too. But here's what I'm doing. You know, having that level of understanding with someone is incredible. So be visible. Don't hide. This is an awesome time for you to be visible. And hey, it's a great excuse to make sure that you're doing a little bit of self-care and looking presentable too, and not just vegging out on the couch.
Love it. And I'll just add, everybody right now is contracting. And mm-hmm. if you start implementing these habits, being visible, using video, working on your communication skills, as everybody is contracting or retracting, you are literally rising. And when this thing ends and the big machine gets going again, guess who's going to be on top? Just saying. All right, we're going to get to number three. This is a big one because Kelly's always on me about trying to practice this more, and it's the big E, and that E is for empathy. And empathy, maybe in these critical times, it's a little easier because, hey, we want to be, you know, caring and supportive and prop people up. But when things are going great and, you know, there isn't a big global virus and there's not a huge financial meltdown and business is good and money's rolling in and customers, empathy can get kind of tucked away. But Kelly is always reminding me, bring it to the forefront. And when we talk about empathy, this isn't just like going, oh, those poor people. This is truly trying to understand. And
my favorite quote is, I can't imagine what you're going through.
Yeah, I can't imagine what you're going through.
You just don't want to.
Or just call me if you need anything.
Yes.
But
Bye-bye.
this component is about not being a business. It's about being human, and it's about treating people with respect and dignity. And a lot of times business gets in the way because of profits. We've got to make money, we've got families. And we're not saying that you're not empathetic or you're not practicing empathy, but right now in the pause, let's focus on how we can really practice empathy. Think about what it takes to not only serve your customers and serve your community, but actually to connect with them and make a difference, not just in what you provide, but in their hearts and minds. And so it's not easy, because it means we have to kind of put ourselves behind and put others in front. So empathy, though, gives us that opportunity. I'm going to move right into number two because that's kind of the second part. This empathy and this one actually go hand in hand, and that one is relevancy. We're seeing just a ton of really distasteful, piggybacking onto, the financial crisis, piggybacking onto this virus with their marketing. And hey, look, I'm all for a chuckle, I'm all for humor. I can be tactless at times, ask my wife. But now is the time to be relevant, and deciding that you want to roll out a campaign around, COVID-19 or the virus or any of that stuff, just not good. So be relevant with your communication. Make sure that you're communicating. And if you have a great product that serves people during these times, that's awesome. But focus on what is your customer's benefit. Focus on what it's in, for them, and that means you're going to be a lot more relevant with your communication. People will relate. Remember, relevancy is about relating. People relate to you. And yeah, it might seem like kind of crass humor, and I mean, everybody needs something to laugh at right now. I'm just saying, but don't mix your communication and your marketing with piggybacking on to just disasters. I mean, people are dying. So, and
Well,
I've,
and we see enough of it.
yeah, and
Everyone's seeing enough of it. So if they can
yeah.
take a pause and see something that's a little more positive.
Yeah. So, and get back to serving your customers. That's a motto that we use. Serve your customers and they will serve you. Reminding them that your product's even remotely related to something that can kill them, that's not relevant. So make sure you guys stay relevant. And I'm not going to preach anymore. We want this to be super positive. Again, there's six of these. We've gone through five. Go to kitchentraffic.com/the dip. We've got a couple resources there as well as a checklist for you guys to kind of work through these. And before we get to number one, I'll just say if you have any questions about what we've talked about, if you think that we didn't cover something, or you're like, ooh, 7, 8, 9, and 10 are these, and they're working for you, or they've worked for you in the past, we'll take those. So hit us up. There's plenty of places to communicate with us on our website and also all the socials. And now, number one.
The number one way to get in front of this thing and be very human is you must have a philosophy. You must have a philosophy. We are begging you to have a philosophy. And when it comes to philosophy, this is not like, the class you took in college. This is revisiting why you are in business in the first place. All too often, we get caught up in the day in and day out of the business. We get caught up in the drama. We get caught up in just one facet of it because that's where you're comfortable, but you don't want to explore other areas. But when it comes to the philosophy, you really have to sit back and think about how you felt when you started your business. What was it that made you so excited to really, go ahead and risk everything, start this business and make it succeed and get out of the startup phase and even be years into this business. What was it that got you started and got you there? And a big thing about philosophy that people forget is a lot of times I'll say, well, you just need to get a philosophy. Then they come back with me with this kind of wah-wah boring mission statement. and they're just like ticking off words that sound great as far as your business and the, you know, this is what I should be doing. This is what I should have in my mission statement. Or my favorite is when people have, they'll throw back their mission statement because they had to write it really quickly to fill in a space on their website.
Right.
No. The philosophy comes from why you're in business and why you even started this business. What is it that really is your passion behind the business? And I can always tell when somebody has nailed their philosophy, Scott, when they call me back and they say, okay, Kelly, I got it. And I can hear the passion in their voice. Mm-hmm. It's like they're talking about their child walking for the first time. It's that passionate. So if you are just ticking off just a list of things that you think your business should be, then you don't have it. Your philosophy comes from the passion, and that's why you're in business.
Yeah, and I'll add just this part right here. There's a really cool example called the Hedgehog Effect, and it's the three circles. So it's your passion. It's what you're really good at, and it's basically your economic engine. So what's the thing that you think you can make money at? And then where they cross over, right there is the philosophy. That's the target. The challenge is most people don't even know what the three circles are. So mm-hmm. they can't even hone in on that target of a philosophy. And I will tell you this from personal experience is that I didn't have a philosophy when I ran my other businesses. Just ran a business, made money. And it came, it went, and when things got tough, I checked out. And I can tell you this, is what a philosophy will do to you. It will determine everything you're willing to sacrifice to see it through.
Mm-hmm.
And when you don't have a philosophy, that line is really low. Like the first adversity, you lose a customer, you get sued, holy crap. Getting sued sucks, I know, but the part of it is the philosophy is what gives you this line here, and everybody's line's different. So I can't tell you what your line's going to be, but I will tell you the philosophy raises that line of what I'm willing to go through, what I'm willing to sacrifice, what I'm willing to put not only myself through to see it successful, and that's why it's number one. It is just such a fundamental piece. And even if you're a leader in a company, let's say you don't own it, but you run it, you're high level management, C-suite, that philosophy too determines what you're willing to do, the sacrifices you're willing to make, the type of people you're willing to bring into your company to see the thing through. And again, without it, you just, honestly, the first time that, what is the saying? If you can't stand the heat, get out of the kitchen.
Yes.
A philosophy, guess what? Keeps you in the kitchen
mm-hmm.
with nicked knuckles and burnt elbows and singed hair and hot, butter, poured on your foot. I mean, it don't matter. You're in it because this is what you love. This is your passion, and that you're good at it, all those things. We always come back to food somehow. Kitchen traffic? I don't know. But the part of it is it is the thing that will help you through any of this adversity. And when things are good, that philosophy is the thing that makes you grab an oar. Like famous saying is, when things are good, grab an oar. Because you're going downstream. So now you're just going even faster, even better. So number one, philosophy. It is so critical to the success of your business, just making it through these bumpy times as well. What else, Kelly?
I think the last thing I'd mention about philosophy is you can always tell when someone has a philosophy because they radiate when they talk about their business. It's just... I mean, they are just so excited and you want to be part of it, right? Mm-hmm. You start thinking like, man, what do they have that I don't have? Or I would love to work for that company. This just sounds amazing. So that's another way to think of it. I think sometimes people will hear us say this, Scott, and they'll probably go to Google and they get the wrong thing here. And it's not all about that. So again, once you write that philosophy statement, believe it and let it come from your heart and write it on a post-it note and put it on your mirror. Make sure that your employees believe it too. And mm-hmm. they're, you know, following it every single day.
Huge point. Yeah.
This is a big part of your business. And, you know, if you think about what has led up to just today, you know, keeping all of the other events aside, this is still relevant and incredibly important.
Yeah, very good. All right, guys, 6 ways that you can navigate all the crap that's going on right now. 6 ways that'll keep you anchored. It'll keep you focused. You can get those at kitchentraffic.com/the dip. We also have another resource on there called The Dip. And that's an amazing worksheet. That'll show you where we are now. And then you have to set where you want to go from here and understand that going from here to here, you're going to go through the dip. And right now we have one forced on us. And that's the hard part, because a lot of times we're the ones responsible for our own dips, because it's things that we do or ways we screw up or whatever. But this one got forced on us. And that makes it hard, because it's like, I didn't want the dip right now. Things are going good. I don't want the dip. But it'll help you kind of see that, understanding that going through this is just, it's human nature. We all have to do it. But it's what have you set up there for the goal? How are you going to get through the dip to get to the goal? So it'll remind you. So those are these 6 steps. We've got a couple other videos coming out this week. We have a webinar coming up in the end of the month. That's going to talk about Apple Orchard, and we'll get into more detail on that. But that's the amazing tool that we found that will show you where hundreds, if not thousands, of extra leads for your business exist. And it's all through the customers you've already served. And let me just finish this. This is my finishing statement, and I'll let Kelly roll out of here with her statement. But when we say serve your customers and they will serve you, that's woven into our philosophy. My personal philosophy for myself and the business, I know Kelly believes it too. But right now, take the things that, all the stuff that's going on, set them aside, try and compartmentalize if you can right now, and think about how you can serve others, not sell them. Obviously, if you sell a product that will help get people through this, that's great. But find other ways to serve, find other ways to help somebody find a little bit of joy in their life in these hard times. And if you can do that right now and do it consistently every day, there, when things get better, they're going to come back in droves. Mm-hmm. And they're going to bring a ton of people with them. So don't hunker down in the bunker, you know, waiting for this thing to pass. Be out there leading your troops, leading your employees, leading your industry. Right now is a great opportunity to come out and just get in front of a lot of people with some service, leading your industry. And when this thing starts to wind down, all the crap, and the sun comes back out and we get into spring and summer, and, you know, in relative terms, those people are going to come and your business is going to thrive. So serve others, serve your customers, and they will serve you. Kelly?
I think another component of that in this, just what has changed so rapidly in the past week, and a word that keeps popping up in various articles I'm reading, and just even reading on Nextdoor, just my neighborhood, is community, which it seems like an odd word, considering we are socially distancing from everyone. However, community is still alive and well in this day and age with technology, and you have to remember that. This is, I do see a lot of people saying, well, this is a great time to sit back and, you know, relax with the family and chill. You know, that is always great for like the first few days. I mean, have you ever been on vacation with your family? it's like my family, we have a 48-hour rule.
It's like the fish. Yeah. Fish and family for the first 2 days, it's good, then they stink, so you throw them out.
That's what it's going to start turning into.
Oh That's
And
funny.
so, I mean, that is the truth. But yet, you have this ability to build community with your customers, and it's just in your community, and
Yep.
find out ways that you can make a difference. Maybe you can't physically bring food to a food bank, but they are accepting money. Maybe there is a way to, like I had mentioned earlier, maybe there's a subscription service you can help somebody out with their kids. I even just read as something as simple as just reading a book to somebody else's child, so the mom can actually have a drink of hot coffee. Just various ways
Right.
to keep your sanity. It can be silly, it can be funny, but it also is one of those ways that you can build trust over time and friendships over time. Scott and I are believers in, not only is it serving your customers so they will serve you, but it is creating those relationships for life. And if you do it right, whether you're faced with a 2001 or 2008 or what we're currently facing, that community and that relationship will supersede any of your numbers, your stats, your product, or sales.
Good done. Put a fork in it. This episode is done. That was great. All right, guys. Again, we'll be rolling these out for you, several of these every single week. We also will get back to our podcast, Sharpen Your Knife podcast. But again, if you have questions, concerns, comments, something we didn't cover well enough, hit us up. We'd love your feedback, and we'll try and make sure each episode is something that is very practical, but also inspiring for you guys as well. So I will finish by saying, stay strong, keep at it. Fortitude is everything right now, and just make sure you're surrounding yourself with people like us that know that you will succeed when you have the right mindset, you've got a philosophy, and you've got a network of people that believe in you, and we believe in you. Anything else?
Good night, everyone.
Good night. Yes, I'm going to bed in a couple hours. All right, we'll see you later.